Okay, so hi guys, Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive Magazine. We are here at the O2 Arena with the one and only Dave Kilminster. How are you doing today? how was last night?
Last night was great. Last night was great, and we celebrated possibly a little too much.
Okay.
Back at the hotel, so feeling slightly fragile today, but I'm okay.
That's understandable after what an incredible show. Now, this, of course, is part of this incredible Roger Waters tour, which you've been, you know, a part of his incredible band now for nearly 16, 17 years.
17 years, yes.
Which is amazing. Of course, this is what we're calling for now, the farewell tour. Don't know if we can ever really believe that these days.
I signed up for a 10-week tour. In 2006, that's what I signed up for, and I'm still here, which is amazing. I mean, it's great. It's obviously life-changing stuff like this, but I certainly wasn't expecting to still be doing this.
Amazing.
We've got South America later on this year. Who knows what's going to happen next year? I have no idea at the moment.
Now, you are going to let us behind the curtain a little bit and see some of your incredible rig for this tour. But just before we move to that, just to take it back to that point where you said that 10 weeks, can you talk us through, like, you know, how did it come to be that you ended up as part of this this band?
I heard that Roger Waters was looking for a guitarist. Mm. My manager told me he just received a phone call from Snowy White, because Snowy used to use his rehearsal facilities.
Sure.
So, and my manager Martin, he was really excited. He came into my room. He said, "Oh, I just heard that Roger Waters is looking for a guitarist." And I'm like, "Who's that?" I had no idea who Roger was.
What?
No, I'm sorry, not a Scooby. I obviously was aware of Pink Floyd, but I was never a huge Pink Floyd fan, I guess. I kind of missed them. I was more into Zeppelin and Queen and Black Sabbath and Pat Travers and all these other guys. So my Martin was obviously a little bit flabbergasted, and he was like, "What do you do?" And then you said something about Comfortably Numb. And at that point, the only version of Comfortably Numb I'd ever heard was the Scissor Sisters.
Okay.
I thought, okay, it's going to be interesting. Yeah, I can do kind of disco. But then I kind of realized, obviously, it wasn't going to be like that at all. So I phoned them up. In fact, I didn't even phone them up, because Martin said, he gave me the dates of the 10-week tour. Hmm. And I said, "Well, I've got some dates with Keith Emerson right in the middle in America." Hmm. So, you know, obviously I can't do it. And I didn't think anything more of it, just kind of, you know. And then I think it was the next day or the day after, I had an email from Keith's manager just saying, "Really sorry, but we're going to have to cancel those shows in America."
Okay.
I'm like, that's a sign, you know. That is definitely one of those things from God, you know, the big, you know, neon pointy things. So I thought, okay, I have to go for this. I mean, still not expecting to get it. I never expected to get it. But I just thought, you know, I was working on an album at the time. I thought maybe I'll meet someone and I can, you know, maybe they'll push my material, whatever.
Sure.
So obviously went for the audition, performed terribly. I mean, it was just hideous. I thought I was prepared, and I clearly wasn't prepared, because I didn't know even about the history of the music. I mean, they said they wanted someone to play and sing like Dave Gilmour. So so we're just about to play Money. And so I'm feeling quite confident, because I've worked out all three guitar parts. So I sort of went to Roger, I said, "Oh, which part do you want me to do? I can do the reggae thing, or just follow the bass line, or do the thing with the tremolo." And he said, "Oh, I don't mind. Are you all right on the lyrics?" I'm like, I'm supposed to sing this. Okay. So the first time I sung it was, Roger Waters was stood pretty much where you were. I've got the lyrics on a little stand and I'm playing the reggae thing and trying to sing this thing, which isn't difficult, but it's something that it's kind of nice if you go through it you know, a couple of times just to get just to get your head around it. So that was a bit of a disaster. Then I realised as I'm playing money, I had two guitars with me, two electrics. One had 21 frets, one had 22. You need 22 to play money for the high bends. And I had the wrong guitar on. So halfway through, I'm like, yeah, really sorry, can we stop? Because I can't play on this guitar. So, you know, and then we did Wish You Were Here, and then the acoustic wasn't working. And it was a nightmare. Really a complete disaster. I just felt such an idiot. I was kicking myself, you know.
So what turned it around then?
I have no idea. They like me. They like me. I think it was one particular... I've heard from someone that was there, a tour promoter. Mm. He said, you did this one solo. You just went for it. And the whole room kind of went, whoa!
Okay.
And I had no idea. I was just in my own private hell, you know. But apparently, that's what they loved. It might have been... comfortably now, I've no idea, but
it was just something that just resonated, because you know, before we started rolling, you know, I was talking about the show last night, which was incredible, by the way. It's always such an incredible show when you guys come into town. But something that I always notice about you is that you're able to bring your own style to everything that you play, but yet there's a respect to the original material, you know, that resonates, and it makes you feel, you know, you might not be going, oh, that's exactly the same sound as a record, but there's an energy there that brings that memory back.
I've just got goosebumps, you saying that again. I don't know, it's something that I try and do.
That's how it feels from sitting right over there, you know, and, you know, so I wonder if that is what they felt. You know, it's this thing about music and language, which is,
sure,
you know, it's an unexplainable thing, I suppose. Uh-huh. Now, as part of this... this tour, just like every tour you guys do, you take this material and sometimes you extend parts out, you change bits, you give it a new skin from time to time. Comfortably Numb has got this incredible treatment that starts the show. Spoilers for anyone who's not seen it. Could you talk us through a little bit about how, you know, putting together a show like this and the actual rearrangement of some of these pieces goes down? You know, is it quite does everyone get involved in it, or is it very much like here's what we're doing and that, stick to that?
People are free to add their opinions, but Roger is obviously the final voice. You know, you can suggest something and he'll just say, no, that's dumb, we're not doing that, which is fine.
You can imagine that.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Yeah, he doesn't hold back. Mm. There's no grey areas. It's very much black and white, which is perfect. Mm. But something like the last tour, for example, when we played Comfortably Numb, there was a few extra bars at the end. Now, obviously, I don't want to start sweeping and tapping and play with my teeth and stuff. You know, you want to try and keep it within the context of the song and the style of the song, really. So I'm the worst Dave Gilmour imitator. I really am. I don't play like him. I don't sound like him. I don't have anything in common with him. For me, you know, it's not someone that I listened to when I was growing up. So it's kind of it's a little tough to sort of improvise in the style of what Dave would maybe do, because he's very much from a blues background. I come from more of a progressive, classical rock thing, I guess. So I usually just have to work something out that's memorable. Maybe even just sing along with the track and then think, okay, I like that, so I'll play that. And, you know, just to try and keep it, yeah. Because I've seen other people play Floyd tunes. Actually, I seem to remember seeing a video with Dave Gilmour. And the guitarist was doing this tapping thing during...
Like in the 80s. I can remember this
That's... I don't know. It just seemed wrong. There was something that was... I've no idea who it was. Sorry, whoever it was. For me, it didn't work. You know, I try and be as respectful to the music as humanly possible. Mm. I try and get... As I said, I don't sound like him. I'm not even fussed about using the same effects or anything, but I try and get the same phrasing, the same nuances, the same little microtonal bends or whatever. You know, I'll try and get that exactly right. And then I can just add my own little personality to that, and hopefully people you absolutely do.
And you know, we know that Pink Floyd fans, and so many, you know, of the biggest bands in the world's fans, they're very discerning, and
yes, you know, oh god, and some of the worst, Jesus,
you know, it's got to feel it's got to feel fantastic to be accepted by that yeah. audience.
There's not been too many negative criticism. I mean, you know, obviously people are going to say it doesn't sound like Dave Gilmour. Well, it doesn't. You're quite right. Yeah. Nobody sounds like Dave Gilmour. Nobody sounds like Jeff Beck.
It's not Dave G. It's Dave K.
So it's going to be, it's going to be my interpretation, not interpretation even, just approaching it like a classical musician would. Okay, these are the notes, this is the phrasing, play that, play it with all your heart and soul, and hopefully people will be happy.
And that's, of course, exactly what you do. Now, I was going to ask, you know, back, my God, it's over 30 years now, but winning that, you know, Young Guitarist of the Year award, you know, I was going to say, like, could you imagine, you know, just last night, you know, you're still playing on, you're playing, you know, another brick in the wall, you got Roger Waters dancing next to you, but of course I now know the answer because you didn't even know who he was. But just to reflect a little bit on those early days and that path that you went with your career, because obviously, you know, so many people like myself, you know, as soon as you hear your voice, you recognise it as much as your guitar playing for those early guitar techniques CDs, and then of course, you know, you go on to do the stuff at ACM, which I was there as well for. And you know, it seemed like it was a real golden era for a lot of the talent. Obviously you've worked a lot with Guthrie, he was part of all that, Pete Callard, Eric Roach, you know, you know, so many incredible players that you worked with. What are some of your memories of that period? And I'm assuming a lot of happy ones.
All happy ones, pretty much, except for Eric. Eric's very sad. I don't even know if I want to talk about that because I'll just lose it. But the rest of it was such. It was such a great time. Hanging out with Guthrie was amazing. I mean, just sitting down and jamming with him. It's like, how can anyone be that good? Seriously, how can anyone be that talented, that musical, that kind of, you know, that technical facility where he can play anything that he hears. And what he hears is incredible, you know. I could maybe sit down and compose something like that and practice for the next 6 months and come up with something, you know, almost, but not spontaneously like that. It's just ridiculous. So I learned a lot from Guthrie just hanging around with him. And in fact, he changed my playing in a quite a big way. I remember I had this pink paisley Telecaster. I don't know if you remember that. I used to teach you that sometimes. And I remember he picked it up once and he was playing it. And I was like, how are you making that sound better than me? Seriously, that just sounds so much better than when I play it. And it's like, he's got really strong hands, really very positive attack, you know. I'm like, I need to play a bit harder, you know. I need to kind of develop that sort of technique where, you know, because his legato sounds like picking sometimes. It's like, just wow. Because most people's legato just sounds a bit kind of soft, you know. So it really made me work on just playing everything more, more positive. You know, because a lot of people, you know, they get a guitar and they kind of fiddle around. It's like, doo-doo-doo. You know, they play the same thing that they did or that they've been playing for the last 10 years or whatever, you know. Pick up the guitar, play exactly the same thing. And it's all a bit soft and stuff. You know? But, you know, so much of the sound, well, all the sound is in your hands. You know, I remember reading that that thing after Van Halen passed. And Steve Vai was saying about the time that Van Halen went to Steve Vai's studio, picked up Steve Vai's guitar, which is going into Steve Vai's pedal board, into Steve Vai's amp, and it sounds exactly like Van Halen.
Of course.
Because of course it does.
Yeah.
So, you know, we'll talk about all the gear and stuff, obviously, but so much of it is kind of how you play, you know.
Of course.
So much of it is, yeah, I mean, I use a really heavy pick as well. I hit the shit out of the strings.
You know, on that note, I think that we should. You're right. Let's get a look at how you make these incredible sounds and make it your own. So should we start with taking a look at the guitars and then we'll move through it?
Absolutely.
So Dave, You've got these incredible axes right here that you use for this tour. Could you just talk us through what we're looking at?
Sure. I was approached by this company late last year, actually, and had a phone call with them. And they built me, this was actually the first one they built. These are kind of unusual. The body is made of chestnut. Yes, exactly. Okay. I don't know anybody else that uses chestnut wood. It's actually old wine barrels, which they kind of reuse. The neck is roasted maple, 24 frets, obviously, which I absolutely love. They make their own tremolos, they make their own pickups, although these are designed by a friend of mine, Matt at Monty's Guitars. So that's what I've been using on all three of these guitars. The most important thing, probably the most important thing, there's no lacquer on the neck, because I don't like I like to feel the bare wood.
Sure.
And actually this feels very organic, I guess. It's not a huge paint job on it. Or
with the walnut body, I mean, did you have
chestnut?
Sorry, it had to be something random there, and I forgot what it was. Did you feel, did you have any reservations about that type of?
Well, I was a little, I don't know. I felt good about the whole thing, to be honest. I had, I like to think that fate looks after me in strange ways. Mm. I mean, and I can probably give you loads of examples, but the fact that I'm stood on stage at the exit would be one of them. So I trusted them. Okay, they use chestnut. Let's see what it sounds like. I've only ever used swamp ash before on all my other guitars. So I thought, okay, let's give this a go. Roasted maple neck.
And in terms of, like, obviously when you were coming to do this, you had a very clear idea at this stage exactly what you what you wanted.
Yeah.
You know, what would be the sort of major differences between, say, Dave Kay from 10 years ago and now that you would change on how the guitar's set up and the materials that'd be used?
Not a huge difference. I mean, the rose thing, which I've kind of had on my guitars since the first Sur guitar I had, has become more prevalent, I guess.
You got the jumbo frets still, on here as well. Has that always been?
Still love the huge. I'm not even sure what they are. 6150s or 5150s, something like
sure.
that.
Sure.
5150. That's the Van Halen thing. This is probably not those. It's not Van Halen frets. But yeah, I like the really high, tall, slightly pointy frets as much as possible. I need a little bit of a V in the back of the neck because I've got fairly small hands. As I said, I don't like the lacquer. They'd lacquered it, so my friend Matt just took all the lacquer off. Probably the most important thing on this guitar, though, is just around the back.
That's it, yep.
Yeah.
That makes all the difference.
It does. My signature, which is on the back of all three of them.
Other brands could have had it.
Well, exactly.
Other brands could
exactly.
have had it.
They just
and just talk a little bit about these pickups. Are these like quite low output?
I would love to talk about the pickups. Matt is a lovely chap, and he wants to do a signature set of pickups. So he made these. He custom made these, which are a little lower output. Really gorgeous for clean sounds, really just, beautiful sounding. Then he put two other sets in, two different sets in, these two other guitars. This one's the hottest one. That's really quite loud, this one. And also it's detuned. So it sounds really heavy. I love this one to bits. I use this one for the Have a Cigar solo, which I do out there. This one's kind of more of a medium one. The reason I'm not telling you what the pickups are is I have no idea. I have no idea because he said, right, I'm going to put different ones in each one. and then you can tell me what you like about each, and then we'll build the perfect
set. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah, I love it too.
And when you think of so many great guitars from the past, a lot of people wouldn't know what it was sure. or how they're wound.
Yeah,
or,
I have no idea what the magnets are, what the outputs are.
That's it.
I just know that they all sound amazing.
Do they all always appear on the same songs?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
And string gauge wise?
Tens, I think. I think they're tens. Well, tens on these two, obviously. This is a detuned one, sure. So this is probably... where's my tech when I need him? Do you know what we... it's probably 11s.
Yeah.
Because it's down... It's like drop D, but down a tone.
Yeah. And, of course, you get the wireless system then for,
the wireless system's
for a
great.
Stage like this. Always,
yes.
Is this a new addition for this tour, or has it always been the same?
Wireless?
Yeah.
I don't know. They're here when I arrive.
And of course, they need to go somewhere.
Someone wrote to me on Instagram the other day, said, oh, what wireless system do you use? I'm thinking, I'm going to have a look at that. I have no idea.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, people are going crazy over what batteries they're using. So, you know, the wireless system, makes a big difference. But of course, they've got to go somewhere. And where they're going to go, of course, eventually, is to these incredible amplifiers. So
yes. We
know that it's not quite... what we're looking at here, of course, is that it goes under the stage, you were
yes,
saying, of course.
Yes.
But if you could talk us through
absolutely
what we're looking at right here.
I don't know why, but this just reminded me of an old Pete Way quote, you know, the bass player from UFOs.
Sure.
Because someone asked him once what amps he used, and he said, I don't know, it's always dark when I go on stage. Which I thought was just such a perfect response.
And you can tell when it's the truth as well. You know, when it's just like, look, I just come and I play the show and make it sound good. So the Brunetti has, of course, been part of your lineup now for quite a wee while. Incredible sound, and it's both clean and dirty.
Yes. They're the same ones as I've been using since 2010, I believe. Mm. And also, as you can see from the top, I used them on the Stephen Wilson tour as well.
Of course.
Which was fabulous. I don't know if you saw any of those shows. That was just so much fun.
I didn't, but it's nice to know that just about every venue in London has seen these amps. You've been in Albert Hall, the O2, all over the place.
Wembley as well. Wembley Stadium we played these.
Incredible.
Yeah. And it's exactly the same amps. I just got these two. I used that one's a spare. It's just kind of there in case. But I've not had to get it out at all.
And is it just sort of stock from the factory? You don't need to change anything?
I think the only thing that's been changed is... because our sound guy on the war tour was saying, you know, these amps sound amazing, but they're so fucking loud. I can't get the PA over the top of them.
Okay.
So Marco very kindly put a switch on the back, which takes them from 50 down to 20 watts. And they're still really loud, but... You know, well, they're incredible. They really are incredible. I love these to bits. And as you said, the clean sound is just gorgeous. It's almost like two amps in one. I've not come across an amp that has such a great clean sound and an amazing overdrive sound. You know, I mean the overdrive sound it sounds like Van Halen 1. Mm. You know, if you stick a guitar with a humbucker through it, you can. It doesn't sound like listening to the record, listening to Eruption. It sounds like you're actually in the studio, stood next to Eddie when he's playing Eruption.
Sure, it's incredible, isn't it? Like, just not to detour a little bit, but you know, so often when people are trying to find that ideal overdriven tone, it goes back to that Brown sound on that first record, isn't it? It's such a benchmark for how people. I mean, I think even this year, like chatting with people, they're still like trying to find that for records and what have you. Just a slight detour. What do you think is like so particularly special about that? You know, obviously the way he plays, but that particular tone that just has resonated through to 40 plus years later.
Hmm. That's a really good question. I mean, obviously, it was him.
Mm.
He made it sound like that. If I played it, it wouldn't necessarily sound like that at all. So
just like we were talking about people plugging into his rig and they didn't sound like him. Nuno was saying it. Yeah.
There's something about when he plays the guitar through that particular system. It's just, it was gorgeous. There was an attack to each note, which I'd love.
Mm.
And it's something that is in my playing. I can't even get rid of it because I was a Van Halen kid. So, every time I hit a note, if I play a note on the G string, for example, I'm going to hit the other three on the way down because I just like that kind of rate thing, yeah. You know.
Excellent.
And it had so much presence to it. So much, I don't know, it was musical but aggressive, and it was rhythmic. It was just, I don't know.
There's a what's and all sort of thing to it as well, isn't there? You know, when it's like on the edge of breakup.
I'd never even heard of him before, but I went to see, this is one of the good things about being old, actually. I went to see a band called Black Sabbath on the, I think it was the Never Say Die tour.
Okay.
And they had a support band from America called Van Halen, who I'd never heard of. So I just kind of went along. Missed a little part of the show, unfortunately. And I walked in and the whole place is erupting. I didn't mean that. The whole place is going crazy. And I'm thinking, oh my God, Ozzy's on already. And I looked over and I thought, that's not Ozzy.
No.
What the hell is going on? They just completely tore the place apart. It was amazing. And I remember then he did his guitar solo. They wheeled on this World War II practice bomb where he used to house the Echoplex.
Sure.
You know, I'm a little kid. I mean, this is just completely blowing my mind. And he's doing the tapping thing and I can, that looks interesting. And literally I went home that night and I just went.
Yeah.
Okay, this works. This is great. This is actually quite easy. It's one of the easiest things you can do.
Man, you're gonna pull out that tapping solo tonight. I know. You were just saying that you don't.
Don't tempt me.
And that nice quiet section comfortably. You're just gonna start tapping away.
It is weird without the solo, I must admit. Because sometimes you can feel the audience are just about to, you know, when the solo's supposed to come in, they're all gone.
Oh, it works though. And it works incredibly.
Oh, I know. And, I can understand why as well.
It's incredible. But back to the Brunetti.
Sorry, yes, I'm just
guessing. It was me that. But EL34s.
Yes.
Any particular reason that the EL34s are working better for you than a 6L6 setup or anything like that? Or is that just
more,
you liked it?
More Marshall, I guess. Is that what they use in Marshall?
Yeah, definitely. And the good ones.
Yes, exactly.
And do we know the valve brand, or is that, you're not fussed about that?
Apparently we've got different ones in each amp. Not for any specific reason other than they were difficult to get hold of during the COVID thing. So in that one we have the JJs, the Teslas. And in this one we have the Svetlanas from Russia. And actually, for the two ISO cabs which are underneath the stage, they are, it's the Rivera Silent Sister system. And we've actually got a different mic on each one, so we're kind of blending. It wasn't my idea, but it's all right.
Yeah.
You know, it works. I think everyone else has just got the typical SM57s on them. And we may even do that for the next tour, because I don't. The thing that freaks me out about a setup like this is there's just too many variables.
Yeah.
I have a wireless system for a start, so I don't know how that compares with the just plugging it in with a with a lead. It goes into this pedal board, which arrived the day that it had to be transported to the. to America for the first show. So I literally set it up during soundcheck. So I don't know how that sounds, because it's going into amps, which are going into ISO cabs, which is going into my ears. And I'm like, so if anything changes, if anything sounds different, I've no idea.
There's a lot of moving parts.
Yeah, exactly.
Has there ever been any consideration to try the digital setup, or is that nothing that interests you?
Sorry.
Fair enough.
No, there was a part of me that, beginning of the tour, when we started using the ISO cabs, I thought, I might as well use digital, this, because, you know, I'm not
convenience,
actually.
Yeah,
I'm not actually feeling anything. I'm not getting any movement from the speakers. So maybe I should do digital. And I just thought, no. I mean, they're getting closer. They really are getting so close now. It's scary.
But if you can't take your amps out for a show like this, when can you?
Exactly. I mean? Exactly.
You're not playing a pub in Romford. Tonight.
I would take them to a pub in Romford happily, because they just rock. I guess I'm pretty much old school. I like to see glowing valves and stuff. They do sound better to me. Analog sounds better than digital to my ears.
Yep. And that's what it's all about. It's all about the individual taste, and you can bring that through. So the amps, we've got this incredible pedalboard that you just touched on slightly. There's some real nice effects in there. Can you talk us through where the whole chain starts then?
I believe it starts there, where it says input. Well, after the wireless system, which is downstairs, and then the lead comes back up there, and I think it goes straight into the wah pedal, which is a shame because I don't actually use the wah pedal. With Roger, there's so many variables. I mean, he likes to change things. He likes to try different stuff. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've got how many have I got? 42 patches programmed for this show. Now, I don't use all of them. Some of them are actually just kind of blank. It's in a space where I think Roger might say, oh, you know what, Dave, maybe you should try a solo on that one, you know, or maybe a different sound, you know. So I've got some space. I've worked with him long enough to know that he likes to mess around with stuff. So I've got a little bit of space, and I've got some pedals that I don't really use, but I could use them if I had to.
Yeah, you need so the moment's notice.
Yeah, exactly. Because it will be. It's like, right, I want that. Why haven't you got that? What's going on?
Yeah. Nobody needs that drama.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So things like the chorus on the far left is not actually used for anything. But the same with the Flint. I don't really use it, but it's got an amazing tremolo.
Incredible pedals from Strymon.
Yeah. Mm. And actually the reverb's amazing on that. I probably didn't really need the Big Sky because, you know, how much reverb do you need in a place like this, you know?
And with the EP Booster, you know, it's such a staple on people's boards these days. When did you first come in, contact with that?
Ooh, I think that was sometime during the war, actually. Just wanted a little boost. I think, I can't remember if Guthrie turned me onto it, or might even have been John Caron, our keyboard player who sits over there. No, I think it was Guthrie, and I just tried it, and I couldn't even tell what it did, but it just made it sound better.
Yeah,
I thought I love this pedal.
It's incredible, so pedals like that are like that. You know, like we've heard Nuno talk about that rap pedal and how like he uses it for a completely different use, and a lot of people can't hear the difference. This, I think, is a similar pedal in that way, that if you're used to that sound, that maybe an Echoplex can add to the tone.
Sure.
You instantly recognise it, and if you don't get it, you don't get it. Yeah. But you feel the difference yourself.
Yeah. 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 It's not huge, but it sounds nicer.
Yeah.
It adds a little bit of fairy dust.
And with
to be technical.
And with the gig rig, obviously, you know, as you mentioned, all the patches and stuff like that.
Yes.
How long you been working with that?
Since I think my first pedalboard was with Stephen Wilson, so that would be 2015. Daniel approached me. He said, "Oh, I'm doing Stephen's pedal board. I can do you one as well."
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, sure. Because when I joined Stephen, he was even more fussy with regards to effects, tones, vibrato. Mm. he didn't like my vibrato. I had to kind of tone it down. Okay. He doesn't like the big kind of rock thing.
Nothing too expressive.
No, which was a shame because I was listening to a lot of Malmsteen at the time, and I was kind of
pure expression.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's what I felt. Yeah. But you know, he hated it. So, I did need something that would do a lot of patch changes very quickly. Mm-hmm. So, so that's when I first met Daniel using the G2, and then last year. I upgraded to the G3, which I'm still actually learning how it works, to be honest. There's so much stuff on it, so much cool stuff on it. But again, I had to learn it during rehearsals.
Sure.
The same with these guitars. I'd never plugged in any of these guitars into a proper amp until the first rehearsal in Portugal for this tour.
Mm.
So I was kind of terrified that first day, you know.
Well,
I'm like plugging in and going, please sound good, please sound good.
Well, it keeps the excitement, that's for sure. Well, and of course, we're looking at the smallest fuzz face on the market. Of course, you've got the MXR
so cool.
Phase 90 in there as well. Oh, no,
yes.
The Phaser.
The 35th anniversary
of course,
Van Halen.
Of course, yeah.
It's got to have the stripes, otherwise it doesn't sound right.
Do these get...
I use that one definitely.
Yeah, these get a run out on the show, yeah.
I use that on the solo in Have a Cigar.
Of course.
In fact, all of Have a Cigar, it's got that phaser thing on it. Yeah. I don't even know if that's what's on the original. As I said, I'm not so anal that I'll be looking up, finding out what he used. I put the phaser on and think, it kind of sounds like it.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, that's just, there's nothing on it. There's nothing on that guitar sound at all, it's just clean. So any reverb you're hearing is kind of in here. It's really nice. You've obviously got all the delay stuff for the... This is really weird, but this is the first time I've played with this cabinet, like, ever. This is the first time I played with a speaker that I can hear since, I don't know, what are we talking, 3 years, four years? This is really odd.
But again,
this made me kind of go, oof. I mean, that's the mini fuzz thing.
Killer.
It wasn't the one that I picked, to be honest. It was there's a light blue one, which I really like. But apparently fuzzes with this kind of setup, there's something about the impedance that it doesn't like most of them.
Oh, I see.
But it likes this one, apparently, which is the bog one, the Band of Gypsies.
Course.
Which apparently sounds different to all the other fuzz faces because it's modelled on a pedal that I'm not a huge Jimi Hendrix fan, so I'm just trying to remember what it was. But there was a particular sound that they were trying to figure out what was making it, and they think it was the overdrive from an Octavia.
Oh.
But without the octave.
Okay.
So that's kind of what that sounds like. I used to use it for the... time when we did that, that big fuzzy
kind of. Well, Roger Mayer will just think that he gets credit for all the tones, you know. Then, you know, doesn't matter what it is. He inspired it, apparently.
This is weird. It's
such a huge sound.
It's all right, isn't it? I don't even know what else to show you.
You can really hear though that you were saying though about how even cut down to 20, it's still super loud.
Yeah. And that's just one of them. I mean, with the two, I prefer 4x12s to be fair, but they wanted something. It's visuals.
Yeah.
The art department is very important.
It's a different punch, though, isn't it? Different
punch, yeah. Yeah, I mean, they sound great, but I kind of like the 4x12s. I like the extra thing that you get. So we do a little bit of that, as you probably remember from...
covers all the electric side of things, but of course a big part of the show is acoustic as well.
Yes.
And so we take a look at acoustic guitars.
Sure,
and
absolutely.
You set up for that.
We've got this Fishman, which is very, very cool.
Who just make everything great.
Yeah. Everything great except the tuner isn't great on it.
Oh.
So we use the snark for tuning. So I use this for the... And I've got the D on top, which is for... I use that for the slide solo. I think the slide solo is probably played on a pedal steel to get that minor third interval. But obviously playing a minor third with a slide is kind of, you know. So you tune it down a semitone. So you get that.
Sure.
I love this slide as well.
Is this rock slide?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
really,
fantastic.
Really cool. Mm. I don't know if the company still exists. Hopefully they do. I contacted them because I needed to get some spares and they just sort of disappeared. But
they're I think for me, like, not that anyone cares, but they are one of my favorites because I'm horrible with slide, but that somehow makes me feel like I can pretend for a minute.
Sure, yeah. I'm not a slide player at all, but I just, you know, that's the only thing I do, I think, with that one. And obviously the handy stand, which is perfect.
Of course.
The Fishman sounds amazing. Mm. And again, there's no reverb on it, you know, because it's in here.
Of
and
course.
It's just sounds beautiful.
Absolutely. So look at the Maton, of course, the Maton's, of course, incredible.
Love
as well.
Yes, I really do love that. It's not something... I'm using at the moment. We've kind of run out of wireless systems because I wanted to use that for the last song when we walk off stage because it sounds much nicer than the acoustic that I use, which is Rogers.
Okay.
Sounds much, much nicer and I wish I could, but unless someone comes up on stage and takes the wireless off of this or puts a wireless on that, off the guitar or something, yeah. It's just, we've never had this many wireless systems before.
Sure.
Got wireless mics, we've got wireless guitars.
And it could be splitting hairs at that point, I suppose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, nobody cares by that point. Everyone's like, oh, yeah, we're going home.
Incredible instrument. So when did you first pick up a Maton?
Last year.
Mm.
Last year. I think I was using, again, one of the songs I was using it on, I'm not using acoustic on that song anymore. It's now electric, so... That's what I mean with Roger. You always have to have extra things. You're never ready. You never have enough.
Yeah.
You never have enough time. You never have enough stuff. Because one day we'll just say, oh, yeah, Dave, maybe you should play bass on that.
Mm.
Okay. I played bass on the War Tour for, I think it's pretty much all the shows, actually, 213 shows or whatever it was. I played bass. And banjo.
Wow.
He just looked at me one day in rehearsals because we're doing the Outside the Wall thing, the tune that we finished with. And I said, you know, because I was playing acoustic and someone else was playing acoustic. I said, oh, just want me to sit out on that. And he said, no, you can play banjo.
Mm.
I'm like, can I?
It's like
that's a surprise.
You look, you can manage it.
I've never played banjo in my life before, so next day a banjo arrives and it's like, okay, this is in a weird tuning, let's work this out. And then just worked out the chords. I had a great time with it. But you just never know with Roger. That's you can't prepare too much for a show like this. You know, you work out all the guitar parts. If you've got time, you work out the bass parts. You can, you know, maybe even double some of the keyboard parts, is whatever. It's just, yeah.
Well, you do never know. And just in your opinion, do we think this is going to be the final tour? Since we never know.
God. 10 weeks. That's all I was signed up for, 10 weeks, and that was 17 years ago, so who knows.
And final thing, because thanks so much for taking so much time to show us, but just that's with your own solo material, it's been nearly 10 years since we had the solo records.
Right.
About time we got a new one.
Yes.
Come on.
Well, it's almost ready. Mm. I've been recording this album, which everything's done except the vocals,
okay,
which I'm going to do in this break. It's got... it's got some amazing people on it. It's got Marco Miniman playing drums, obviously. Nick Beggs is on bass. Adam Holtzman, who, you know, this is most of the guys that I played with Stephen Wilson.
Sure.
But Adam, he used to play with Miles Davis. I mean, seriously, how, you know. And I got him to play, there was this one track, which was a kind of a gospel tune. And there was two solo sections. So I wanted a kind of electric piano thing there, and then I was going to do a guitar solo later on. So he played over the first bit. He gave me two takes. He said, I can't really decide, but, you know, pick which one. I'm like, you bastard. Because they are both amazing. So now that tune has two keyboard solos.
Fair enough. Because
it's just, it was just, you have to hear it.
Yeah,
I really can't wait to finish it.
Yeah.
So,
well, please do send over to us. We'd love to get a preview of whenever it's available, and you know, maybe get together and do another feature on that.
Sure.
if you're available.
I'd love
that. I know you're a very, very busy man. But look, thanks so much for taking the time. Good luck in tonight's show.
Thank you.
And the rest of the tour. And thanks very much, Dave.
Thank you. That was a pleasure.